weighed in the balance and we're not found lacking any longer. Why? Because we made it right before the King, and now we're about to enter into the season when we can be considered the co-regent, the bride of the King. We can enter into that season when we know that we have achieved the purpose that we've been called for. That ought to get you excited. You should say that always. If you're not excited, then your wood's wet. You're not on fire. Yom Kippur, Leviticus 23, chapter 23, verse 27 through 32. We're going to look at some things that's rich in tradition. And there's a lot of mystique. There's a lot of things about the festival of Yom Kippur. In fact, it's relegated to as one of those festivals that literally cannot be properly kept. Why? Because there's no standing temple. No standing priesthood. Some believe that that particular group of priests that were responsible for that particular festival have been completely done away with. I submit that's hogwash. Hello? Yeah. In my opinion, nothing can detract from the significance of the high priest who went into the holy place once a year. And we understand that that was a shadow picture, or prefiguring, if you will, of the work of our Messiah, who would himself go into the holiest of holies. We understand that. We also understand that on that day, known as Yom Kippur, it was the day when the high priest would go in and he had on his mind the national condition of Israel. And we see that because right now we're in the middle of a kind of a conundrum as citizens of the United States, because we're about to see what I believe is the greatest calamity or potential for calamity that this country has ever seen. And so we understand. It's one thing I know about me as an individual. I know where I'm at. I know my personal condition. I see that. But I wonder about the national condition of the people. And so the high priest had this responsibility. First of all, he would go in and offer up the blood of a bull for himself. And so he knows when he goes in this final time to offer up the blood of the lamb on the altar, that he's going in on behalf of the nation. Can you imagine the weight and the responsibility of all of that entire nation on his shoulders? Knowing that if he fails, listen to me carefully, if this man fails in his duty, that the sins of the nation will not be expunged this year. That staggers me. We forget sometimes that we are, in fact, our brother's keeper. We forget sometimes that our own personal relationship with Yahweh has a direct impact on other people, and we forget that we have a responsibility to ensure. I know we look outside of our household and that doesn't ring true to us, but on the other hand, inside of our household, there is a measure of responsibility for the spiritual condition that your household is in. And all we figure is that I got to make it in. Well, I just need to make it in. Well, what about those that were here? I thought often about Moshe. And here's a man that walked us in the foreshadowing of Yeshua. Moshe said, "Father, if you don't go with us, then blot my name out." How many of you are willing to do that? There's some traditions that surround this Festival of Atonement, this fast day of Atonement, this season known as Yom Kippurim, that's been hidden for us. And I believe it's been hidden so that it can be revealed at just the proper moment in history when you would need some access to this understanding that will cause you to have a more profound walk with the Messiah than you've ever had in your life. So what I want to do, I want to kind of peel back the cover, and hopefully we'll look at some things regarding Yom Kippur that'll help you. Yom Kippur is translated in the English as just that, the Day of Atonement. But if you look at it in the Hebrew, and I want to stipulate something before we go any further, I submit to you that you cannot understand the word of Yahweh properly. You can get a little bit of it, but you cannot properly understand the word of Yahweh. You'll not get the meaty things. You'll not get the hidden mysteries revealed to you unless you're able to go and look into the Hebrew language. And if you take exception to that, let me clarify. I'm not saying that you have to be literate in the Hebrew enough that you can pick up a Torah scroll and read it. What I am saying is that there's absolutely no excuse in today's society for you not to be able to pick up some sort of a tool so that you can take the language of the scriptures and go back to the language of creation and see it properly defined for you. There's no excuse. There's never been a generation like this one. You have at your disposal every tool you need to learn the mind and thoughts of Yahweh. And it's defined in the Hebrew language and no other. You have, turn to your neighbor and tell them, you've got no excuse. The literal translation in the Hebrew is Yom HaKippurim. Say that with me, Yom HaKippurim. And it means the day of coverings. Did you hear that? Coverings. You know, it doesn't take a scholar to kind of do some reasoning here and say that means there must be more than one covering that's being alluded to, right? And I'm asking myself, and I'm looking at this, why is it translated in the singular form when the Hebrew calls it Yom HaKippurim, the day of coverings, a multitude? And I believe that in order for you to get a little bit more of a clue from the, that you can't see in the literal text, you can see it if you go back and look with me in Genesis chapter 3. Can we go there? Yes. I believe, and again, you may take exception to that, but I believe if you look in the Hebrew language, you'll see that it's pretty plain. I'm convinced that Genesis chapter 3 is the first occurrence of what we would call today a Yom Kippur event, a Yom Kippurim. Look with me. Now, most scholars acknowledge that Adam would have been created on Yom Teruah, which is the Day of Trumpets. Now, if that's the truth, we know that Adam was not created an infant, right? Adam was created a full-grown man. The moment that Adam was created, he set into creation as the king. He was coronated. He was crowned. He was given a title on Yom Teruah, which would, again, be juxtaposed against the Messiah. And you would find that the Messiah also, like the kings of Israel, all of the kings of Israel would be coronated on Yom Teruah, the Day of Trumpets. I want you to get that in your mind, because there's a day in front of us when the King of Glory that we've been singing about is going to make his entrance once again into the literal physical earth, and you as a company of believers are going to crown him king according to the chronological calendar of Yahweh on the festival day known as Yom Teruah, the day of shouting. Okay? And if what I'm telling you is the truth, and Yahweh has followed that chronological pattern, we see it in the spring festivals, when we know that he was executed on the 14th at sundown, and 3 days later on the 17th, he rose from the dead, and then there was a 40-day season when he was walking with his disciples. 10 days later, they celebrated the festival of Shavuot. So we know that he follows a chronological pattern. And if that's the case, then the fall festivals are going to be followed exactly the same way. And so if there's a day in front of us when we're going to see him enter into the earth, and you and I are going to crown him as king, are you with me? Then that means 10 days later there's going to be a festival or a day known, set aside as a day of Yom Kippur, a day of coverings. And then 5 days later, we will enter into the sukkah, the intimate place, and be with him. It has to fall out that way. You see that? Now, if Adam's created on Yom Teruah, the day known as the Feast of Trumpets, and if you follow the events in Genesis chapter 2, you see in the chapter 3, if you don't understand what happens in chapter 3, there's a book out called The Serpent's Seed. You need to get the book. It'll help. Genesis chapter 3 gives you some very powerful insight regarding what occurs there in chapter 3. And if you look at it, you find just as soon as that encounter the serpent has with a woman, you find that there's someone walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And if you read the Hebrew language, it literally tells you that he was arriving at a specified time. I'm convinced that he would have been arriving at the very time that the lamb would later be slaughtered in the afternoon between the evenings to fulfill this rehearsal known as Yom Kippur. It was a divine appointment. It was a holy convocation. You see, Adam and Eve have sinned. They've fallen short of the glory of Yahweh. Isn't that right? They are now unclothed. They are without a covering. They have no mediator for them. Like you and I, like the children of Israel, without what happens next, there's absolutely no hope for Adam and Eve. And subsequently, there cannot be any hope for anyone that will come out of the loins of Adam afterward. And that includes you. And so if you watch this, you see that what happens is that the serpent begins to set the precedent. The serpent usurps the authority. He usurps the place of the king. He enters into the holy place and he compromises Adam and Eve with their will, I submit to you. Are y'all following me thus far? Yes. The serpent enters into the holy place known as Gan Eden. If you understand typology, you'll find that the Garden of Eden would have been constructed, laid out, like you will see a smaller version known as the Tabernacle of Yahweh. And the holy place, or the holiest of holies, would have been this central location known as Gan Eden. Eden was a greater, larger part of the tabernacle. And it's patterned after the holiest of holies in the heavens. And so you see the serpent usurping the authority of Yahweh, and he enters into that holy place and he sets himself up as the object of worship instead of the one who's up until this point been the covering for Adam and Eve. Are you seeing a pattern? If you fast forward in Daniel chapter 9, you read about a future anti-Messiah. And this future anti-Messiah is going to stop the morning and evening oblations. He's going to enter into the tabernacle, or the holiest of holies, and he's going to set himself up again, just like this serpent did, as the object of worship. Now, what I want you to grasp is that our enemy understands the significance of the calendar of Yahweh. And it's to our best interest, and that's one of the reasons that right now, if I were to stop this teaching and start asking you, which calendar do you observe? How do you keep the festivals? I could probably get at least 3 different opinions regarding how to keep the calendar. And it's the issue regarding the calendar that has been the most divisive among the people that call themselves believers. And I submit to you that it's not an accident. I believe with all my heart that it's been something that's been designed from the very inception of creation, and Yahweh is about to reveal to us how to properly keep his divine appointment so that we can be at the right place at the right time.
Amen.
Yes. There was a song one time. I was in the right place. Must have been at the wrong time. Some of y'all remember that. Some of y'all been in that particular predicament. Amen. So you see there in Genesis chapter 3 that Adam and Eve fall. They are divested of the original covering that they had, which would have been the covering of Yahweh, the light, the presence, the word of Yahweh that literally enveloped them because of the fall, the tete-a-tete that occurred with the serpent. Adam and Eve are now without covering. The first thing they do is the same thing you and I do. We attempt to justify our unclean or our naked condition by covering ourselves with some sort of fleshly formality that takes the place of the presence of Yahweh. More times than not, we call it religion and tradition. Are you following? It's not sufficient. Yahweh himself understands that unless there is a proper atonement made for Adam and Eve, then his plan now has been subverted. And so Yom Kippur now has to become Yom Kippurim. Because the purpose of Adam and Eve, according to creation, was to be fruitful and multiply and replenish, subdue and have dominion. Adam and Eve could have been covered themselves by the blood of the Lamb, and that would have been sufficient. Adam and Eve would have been okay. But because of the sin of Adam and Eve, from that time forward, everything that issued out of the loins or the womb of Adam and Eve was created in the image of Adam, not the image of Yahweh. And they lost that covering, so there had to be subsequent covering. Does that make sense? Hence, Yom HaKippurim. It's one thing to cover Adam and Eve. It's another thing to provide a covering for all of those who would later issue out of the loins of Adam. Can you see that? The coming anti-Messiah is going to counterfeit the high priest. That high priest would have been instructed to enter into the holy place for the purpose of sprinkling blood on the sacrifice And that purpose was there to sanctify the nations. And again, you see, that's typified, as we were alluding to, by the first blood sacrifice that was made there in Genesis chapter 3. And I have people that argue. It doesn't say anything at all in Genesis chapter 3 regarding a blood sacrifice. And I'll have to stipulate that in the English it does not. And so I'm, quite frankly, if you look at this argument in the English, I'm undone. But if I look in the Hebrew, I think that I can prove to you that what I'm saying is the truth. Can I do that with you? Genesis chapter 3, verse 21 says, "Unto Adam also and to his wife did Yahweh make coats of skin and he clothed them." I have two words in bold type: coats and clothed. Say that with me. And so I have a question presented here for you. Truth or tradition? And honestly, if you cannot answer these questions, if you're about to enter into an argument with anyone who's an agnostic or atheistic or a traditional Jewish believer who's taking a position opposite than yours because you believe that Yeshua fulfilled this, then you don't, if you don't have an argument that you can come to a conclusion with, then you're also undone. Say amen. Amen. Now I want you to look at this word coat. In Hebrew, it's the word ketonet. Say that. Ketonet. It's defined as a tunic or a garment that covers. But if you look at how it's spelled with a kaf, tav, nun, tav. Now look at that word. Ketonet. See it up there? Strong's number 3801. See, you don't have to be fluent in Hebrew to understand that that is a letter kaf, a tav, and then a nun and tav, and you read it from right to left. That's not hard, is it? And all you have to do is get one of the basic primers for understanding the Hebrew alphabet called Hebrew Word Pictures by Frank Seekins, and it'll show you exactly what I'm about to share with you. That word ketonet is comprised of two-letter roots, the kaf tav and the nun tav. The kaf tav means to write something, to engrave something, to cut. And the nun tav indicates to cut a sacrifice into pieces. Did you see that? Look a little bit further. The word clothed, Strong's number 3847, say this with me, labash. The word labash is translated here as to dress or to put on a garment. And again, if you break it apart, you have a lamed prefix to the front of it, and then you have a beit shin. The lamed prefix means to or towards something. The beit shin root indicates shame. So if I take those two words, coat and clothed, I can use those two words from a Hebraic position and prove that there was a blood sacrifice, and the purpose of that was to provision Adam and Eve with a garment of skin that had resulted from a blood sacrifice, and the purpose of that was to cover their shame. Can you see that? By the way, the word labash, if you change the vowel points, it becomes the word labush, and it's a Hebrew euphemistic word that means wife. And if you read in Malachi chapter 2, verse 14, when Yahweh is admonishing the children of Israel, in particular the males, to not deal treacherously, with the wife of his youth, go back and read that. It talks about covering with a garment of shame, to deal treacherously. And if you look at it, it's that word labush. And Yahweh's telling you as a husband, don't deal treacherously with your wife. Why? Because I was a witness to your union. Now the reason I'm sharing that with you is because it's very apropos to what we're looking at today. Okay? I believe that it's here that you first see the plural meaning of the word kippurim. Why? It's because Adam and Eve had to have a covering, a blood covering, something that would restore them to right relationship with Yahweh. But it was more than just Adam and Eve, because the moment that they fell, listen to me, they ceased to be, anything that came out of the union between Adam and Eve ceased to be created in the image of Yahweh. Does that make sense to you? And so of necessity, as a byproduct of the union of Adam and Eve, you're no longer created in Yahweh's image. You're created in the image of Adam. That's why you're told that you're being conformed into His image. You're being changed. How can you be changed? You have to have a DNA change. It changes in the marrow. Are you with me? And so there had to be a subsequent covering, and that covering involved all of the descendants, all of the progeny that would have issued out of the loins of Adam and Eve's union. Does that make sense? And so that's one of the reasons for Yom HaKippurim. But let's dig a little bit deeper. Are you enjoying yourself?
Yes.
Let's look at that word Kippur, which is the singular word out of Yom Kippurim. Kippur. Depends on how you pronounce that pay. It could be pronounced a fay with a PH sound. And so you could call it kafar. The word kafar indicates to cover something with pitch. The word pitch is an old Elizabethan English term. If you remember Genesis chapter 6, when the ark is being created and it's pitched, covered with pitch of bitumen, something that would come from a resinous tree, we would call it turpentine back home. Y'all heard of that? There's hope for you. But this word here, Kippur, is actually translated as atonement, redemption, to cover, to purge, and to pacify. Now, if you just pacify Yahweh, when I hear that, I kind of get the idea that if you're just kind of squeaking past here, we're not really, the relationship's not what it's supposed to be, I'll just pacify it. Right? It indicates in order for me to be restored properly, then I need to do a little more than just pacify.
Yes.
Come on. Amen. How many of you have ever given a baby a pacifier?
Yeah,
it's a little bit, you satisfy them for a short period of time. Why? Because they need some nourishment. They need relationship, and the relationship comes that they're looking for comes from that relationship with mom or whoever it is that's giving the bottle. So the pacifier just gets you by for a little while. Does that make sense? There's another place that this word Kippur is used, and it is used in Exodus chapter 30, verse 12. And at this particular place, this is the incident when Yahweh's telling the children of Israel that you can ransom every individual with a half shekel. How many of you remember that? Do I need to go there and read it? Nobody remembers it? I saw one hand. Okay, thank you. This is kind of an interactive deal here, okay? If you don't interact, that means we're going to be here longer. The more you interact... Not really. The more you interact, the more excited I get. The more excited I get, the more we might stay. In Exodus chapter 30, verse 12, that word Kippur, the vowel parts are changed, and it becomes a word that means to ransom. Now, what does that word ransom mean? The word ransom means that a life is exchanged for another. Right? If you exchange your life for another, literally, I want you to think about what you're saying. It means you're willing to lay down your life so that the other individual could go free. Right? And so the instance where the half shekel is used, the half shekel becomes the ransom price. So the half shekel then represents the life of the individual that it was given for. Does that make sense? Well, remember that. Because Yeshua became your half shekel. Yeshua became your ransom price. Now, I'm about to jump off into some areas, and I know when I get into this next little source, if you've had a chance to look at it, you probably have already kind of primed yourself. We're just going to get in this because I don't know if I'm going to believe what he's about to tell me. Okay? We're going to get off into some stuff, and I'm asking you to reserve your judgment until you hear me out. Okay? In the book called Song of Songs, a Song of Solomon, the same word Kippur or Kofar, because the vowel portion changed, you can see it in Song of Songs 114 or 711, and it's translated there in English into the word henna. Say that with me. Henna. Now, when I run across things like this, because I'm one of those individuals, I'm kind of inquisitive. Brenda says I'm nosy. When I see these kinds of things, I have to stop and go kind of do a little research and dig it out and find out why this all of a sudden this word that's been translated kafar as a cover, as a ransom, as an atonement. Now it's the same word, the vowel points have changed, it's the same Hebrew letters, it's the word kafir, and it's being used as the Hebrew, as the English word henna. How many of you have ever heard of a henna plant? Henna is an aromatic plant that's used for perfumes and dye. Listen to me. And as I said, if you can see the bottom, here's where things kind of get intriguing. Henna was used for hair dye and ritual, listen to me carefully, ritual temporary tattooing. It's still used today. It's been used for centuries in the ancient Near East. And it's used, and listen to me carefully, because I don't want the walls to go up. Okay? We're going to do like the march around Jericho if you do. We're going to make the walls come down. It's used even today in the same premarital rituals. And in these premarital rituals, for generations, the bride would cover her hands and her feet with intricate designs taken from the dye of the henna plant. And it's said, according to the traditions, that those designs were secret meanings that were reserved only for the intimate relationship with she and her husband. Now, I want you to kind of put your mind away from worrying about tattooing all of a sudden. Oh, it's tattooing. Kind of put your mind away from that and look at it a little bit outside the box, okay? Because there's something going on here. And if you look a little bit further in Song of Songs, you'll find that as the woman who's being, you know, she's the central focus of the book. She's the woman who's being courted by two individuals, okay? Solomon and her lover, the one that she's intended for. Now, if you continue to read, you'll find that her beloved one, how many of you remember the phrase? Say it again. Ani, Ladodi, Ladodi Li. I am my beloved and my beloved is mine. That is one phrase that you see in a lot of marriage ceremonies, all the Hebrew ceremonies for weddings. And it's taken from pretty much right here in the Song of Songs. And if you go back and read it, you'll find that her beloved in this same book where henna's used to represent a dye, he is also referred to as a kofar, as a covering. Isn't that odd? The same word. Now, I'm telling you that when Yahweh does something like this, he's not lost his mind and just run out of words to use. He's put this here to teach you something that if you're not willing to look a little bit deeper than the surface, you'll never see what the analogy is supposed to mean. And by the way, I wish Nietzsche was here because she deals with essential oils. By the way, essential means essence of the oil, okay? And if you take henna and hyssop and mingle them together, it's called a redemption oil. You say, by the way, henna has a red color. Okay? And hoary minds want to know. Now, throughout the Torah, the priest's role is supposed to mirror that of the bride. Amen? You agree with that?
Yes.
Can I ask you a question? If you believe that the role of the priest has now been set aside, then what happened to the fact that she was mirrored, the priestly role mirrored that of the bride? Does that mean that the bride's now set aside as well? If you study the pattern, it was the pattern of the tabernacle was designed in the form of the man. The man represented the husband, the Messiah. And if you understand, you had the children of Israel that represented the bride. And when those priests came in, they were ministering to the husband. The priests represent the bride who ministers to her husband. And vice versa. You see that. So if you do away with the role of the priesthood, you've actually set aside the role that's defined there for the bride. And her role is ministering to the priest. I'm just saying. Well, throughout the Torah, you'll see that the role kind of overflows one another, kind of overlaps. The priest represents the bride. And in Exodus 30, 18 and 19, we're told that there's a brazen laver that's built. And that the brazen laver, listen to me carefully, this particular implement was given only to the priest. No one else could use the brazen laver. How many of you know what the purpose of the brazen laver was? I guess one, two. I saw two hands. Anybody? The brazen laver was for one purpose. That's so that when the priest, now I want you to think about this. His duties were to slaughter animals. It was a bloody job. It was a dirty job. Okay? And when, if you've ever been involved in anything like that, sooner or later you get so much on you until it's just, you just get used to it, right? How many of you ever killed an animal? And I don't mean that in, I'm talking about hunting or something like that. Okay? Whatever. I'll have the tree huggers probably on me after this. My point is if you, after you've gotten your hands in it and gets gotten on your clothes and you just kind of get to the point where it doesn't matter, let's just get the job done. And this priest is doing this over and over and over. But before he can go into the holy place, he has to go by the brazen laver, and the purpose of going by the brazen laver so that he can look and see if his hands and feet are clean. It doesn't say anything about the rest of his body. I'm thinking, go figure that one. It's supposed to represent a mirror because it was made out of the hand mirrors of all of the women of the nation of Israel. And so literally it's there as a mirror. And when he goes into the holy place, he has to look at himself. How many of you have mirrors in your house? Why do you go by the mirror? So I can look at myself, right? Don't you want to look your best if you're about to approach the one who's really close to you? You want to have an intimate relationship? You do everything. Some of you ladies, I watch you. And I've watched, this is what, and I'm just going to step off for a second, get out from under the anointing and get into this. I've watched ladies driving with a cell phone and one of these things, what do you call it? Lipstick on it. A cell phone and lipstick. I've seen it. Now, I want her to look good. My wife is beautiful. She doesn't have to have it. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. My point is, we want to look good for the King. When we go into the holy place, we have to go by the brazen laver. Now think about this. The word for labor here is the word kior. Say that with me. Kior. How many of you remember Eeyore? Oh, nobody cares. When Joy was little, she watched that. And it got to where we had to deal with that. Because Joy walked around, nobody cares. Nobody loves. But this word kior is it's kind of, to me, it has a principal place in our relationship with Yahweh. Because like it or not, there may not be a standing temple. And these implements may not be there naturally, but you have a brazen laver called the word of Yahweh that you're required, before you go into the presence of the King, that you're required to look and see if you are guilty of blood. Now think about that. The word kior is translated as a pot, basin, or laver, and it comes from the word kur. Listen to this. This is interesting. That word kur is a verb that means to pierce, to stab, or to puncture something. And if you were to break the word kior down, you have the kaf, and then you have the yod, vav, resh. The kaf means to or toward or for something. Yod, vav, resh, the root of it there means light. Isn't that odd? It can mean light. Go for the light. Go towards the light. It's for the light. Its purpose is for the light. Psalm 22:16, and I know you're probably wondering why we're kind of dancing around this thing, but I want you to see the connection here with this word kofor and henna and being ransomed. Psalm 22:16 tells us the Messiah would have his hands and his feet pierced. Isn't that odd that it would just kind of accidentally fall out that it was connected to taking the hint of this red dye and applying it to your feet and to your hands? Do you think maybe that you and I if we're representing the Messiah in the earth, that if we go before Him, if our words, see, we don't sacrifice the animals anymore, but we sacrifice one another. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, I'm sorry. We gut one another quite frequently. And yet we come into His house and we go by the brazen labor. We've been doing this for so long. Why don't I want to check now? I've got so much on me. It doesn't matter. A little bit more is not going to matter. Say amen right there. You see what's happening? The priest would sacrifice the animals and they would pierce them and they would cut them, they would gut them, and then they would be required to wash away the guilt of blood from off their hands and feet before they went into the holy place. Now, how does that relate to the husband and wife? The husband and wife, when we're intimate with one another, when we go into the bedchamber, it's considered the holy place. And there's absolutely no reason, ladies or men, that you should go into the holy place about to have the kind of an intimate relationship with your spouse that Yahweh's designed from the foundation of the world when you're guilty of blood. It means that our relationship, one with another, that we should constantly be seeking atonement at woman, that we should constantly be washing ourselves in our relationship so that she has no offense against me and I record nothing against her. When I go in to be intimate with my wife, there should be no blood on my hands. You see what I'm talking about? What happens here is that, in my opinion, when you see this situation where the bride is putting the henna on her hands and her feet, it's to acknowledge that her husband has ransomed her. He's given himself life for life. That's the role of the husband. The role of the husband is life for life. That's why when we see the pattern in the New Testament of Yeshua and His bride, it says that the husband should give himself like Yeshua gave himself for His bride. It's life for life. We become the ransom for our wives and for our children. And the priests, when they went past the labor, they had to make sure that they'd been cleansed of their own blood guilt. And therefore, it's my opinion that it's not an accident that Yom Kippur is also the day known as the wedding mikvah in preparing for the wedding ceremony at Sukkot. Did you hear that? It's interesting because if you study this, before the husband and wife could ever go into the marriage ceremony, they had to go through a ritual mikvah. Isn't that what the brazen laver is? Isn't the brazen laver a ritual mikvah, a washing? Did you know what the rabbis teach? The rabbis teach that every time a husband, a woman, and man gets married, that they have their own individual Yom Kippur. Yeah. And according to what the traditions teach, and I believe that they're right, they teach that every time a husband and wife get married, and it's like they had their own Yom Kippur celebration, and now those two individuals are in the same condition as Adam and Eve were when they were clothed. They were just like they were before the fall. Wow. Hallelujah. To me, that's powerful. To me, that's powerful. Well, you're thinking, those of you that are married, you're thinking, well, we need to renew our vows on a regular basis. You don't have to renew your vows on a regular basis. You just need to go past the brazen laver occasionally. Some of your wives should have said, hallelujah. Right? Some of your husbands ought to say, hallelujah. We just need a ritual mikvah occasionally. Let's look a little bit further. One of the other areas that I find a lot of people in consternation over is the idea of the two goats that are offered during Yom Kippur. Have you ever wondered about that? Anybody besides myself? We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about the scapegoat. And that's a modern term that you see used today. And it means that somebody who's set aside that's guilty for whatever else someone else has done. He's the one that's going to take the fall for it, right? So I want to talk to you a little bit about the eternal scapegoat. Can we have a few minutes, y'all okay? When properly understood, we see some evidence here in the Yom Kippur significance in Leviticus 16:18, and it tells us that Aaron shall cast lots upon two goats, one for Yahweh and the other for the scapegoat. Now I want you to be really careful here because this is an area where people get in all sorts of arguments. You read there, one goat for Yahweh, the other for Azazel. And there are a lot of people Jewish, Christian, Hebrew roots that believed that Azazel was a demonic spirit that inhabited the wilderness. And some believe that this Azazel, the goat that was designated for Azazel, it was sent off into the wilderness to this demonic spirit and this pagan deity in order to appease it. Have you ever read that? Ever heard that? There are a lot of people believe that Azazel represents Satan. And so you had a goat for Yahweh and a goat for Satan. I believe nothing's further from the truth. Let me ask you this. Would you mix paganism with Torah?
No.
You're lying. How many of you celebrated Easter? How many of you celebrated Christmas? Oh, celebrated. It was in past tense, by the way. But I'm just showing you how easy we mix pagan things with the Torah, with the Scripture. You see what I'm saying? And so that's why we need to go back and kind of examine some stuff. And if you've got the blood on, you need to go by the labor. All right? And the reason I'm sharing this with you is because Leviticus 17, verse 7 through 9 says, "And they shall no more sacrifice their sacrifices unto he-goats, after which they play the harlot. This shall be a statute forever unto them throughout their generations, and you shall say unto them, whatsoever man there be of the house of Israel, or of the strangers that sojourn among them, that offereth a burnt offering or sacrifices, and brings it not unto the door of the tent of meeting to sacrifice it unto Jehovah, to Yahweh, that man shall be cut off from his people." And so I submit to you that there's no way that there could be a goat designated as a sacrifice for Yahweh and a goat designated as an offering to appease HaSatan. I just don't see how it could happen. Amen. I might be wrong. And so I also have to ask, why is there the need for two goats? It sounds as if, and there's a lot of speculation here, because, and people argue about it. You may not have, but a lot of people argue that the purpose of two goats is because they had two distinct reasons for having them. Again, one for Yahweh and one for appeasing this pagan deity or appeasing this demon in the wilderness or appeasing Satan. But if you go back and read the Torah, how many of you read the Torah? It says very clearly, you can even see this in the English. So none of you have got any excuse. It says that they were singularly offered for a sin offering. Two goats as an offering. Two goats for the offering. Do you see that? What does that mean? It means one is slain for sin, and the other has the same sins transferred to it and sent away. Does that make sense to you? Well, it still seems like there's a dual purpose here. Hold on, okay. Now, if you read verse 8, again, it tells us very clearly in the text that one goat is for Yahweh, who is a person. How many of you believe that he is an entity? He is a being, a person. Well, if you're going to be grammatically correct and you say that the other is offered for Azazel, he's being juxtaposed or set opposite of the other goat that's being offered or the person that the other goat's offered to. And so if Yahweh is a person, then Azazel also has to be a person in order to be grammatically correct. Say that. Grammatically correct. Well, then who is Azazel here? Who is it that receives this goat offering? Nope. Let's look a bit further. Let's look at the word Azazel. It's written in Hebrew, Ayin Zion, Aleph Zion Lamed. And it's usually translated as entire removal. It indicates that the sins of the nation are placed, transferred as the priest puts his hands on the goat's head. The sins of the nation are transferred to the head of this goat. And tradition says that a fit man, and most traditional sages say that it was a Gentile. Go figure that one. That the Gentile would then take that goat for Azazel and lead it out into the wilderness. And there's some other traditions associated with this. It cannot be found in the Torah. Okay? We're going to look at those. What happens here is that the rabbis struggled for generations regarding the goat and the issue of sin being banished forever. And, like you and I, we have a tendency to second guess Yahweh. Now, I want you to think about this. You're standing outside the temple on the day known as Yom Kippur. And you know that you've been a bad boy. Okay? And you know you need your sins transferred to a goat. Hello? And so you bring your sin to the tabernacle and you confess your sin, and the priest takes that sin, he literally is representing you, and he transfers it to the head of this goat, right? And the goat's sent out into the wilderness. Now, if I were you, I'd say, what if he wanders back into the camp? Somebody's going to know my sin. Hello, my sin's come back to find me. Some of you have some boomerang sin. You just can't throw it away. Hello? You exile that sin, and guess what? The sin's coming, right? And that's what the sages thought. And so in order to remedy that, they come up with a tradition where they would take that goat, instead of sending it off into the desert, they would take it and throw it off a cliff and kill it. My sin's not coming back. Hello? And you see that same struggle in the pattern in Luke chapter 4, where Yeshua's in the wilderness. Guess what? Yeshua's in the wilderness and he's being tempted, and you've got an individual that looks at the traditions of the Pharisees, and so he's going to tempt Yeshua with these very traditions. And he did that quite frequently, I might add. And Yeshua showed him the truth versus the traditions. And this entity known as HaSatan in the wilderness says, why don't you let me take you to the temple top? And he takes him to the top of the temple, and he tempts Yeshua to throw himself off. He knows that Yeshua is the goat for Azazel. He also knows that Yeshua is the goat for Yahweh. And so what he's trying to do is to get you, Yeshua, to follow the traditions of the Pharisees and throw himself off. That's probably never happened to you. Why is this? Well, if you understand, if Yeshua had thrown himself off, then he would have had to acknowledge his inability to forever atone for the sins of man. And it would have diminished the blood sacrifice. Do you see that? And so Yeshua answers, thou shalt not tempt Yahweh your Elohim. Which just so happens to be a quote from Deuteronomy 6, verse 16. And the word here for tempt is Strong's number 5254. It's the word nasa, and it means to test or to put to test, to put someone to the proof. And it's interesting because the statement follows a verse where Yahweh declares that he is a jealous Elohim, and his anger is kindled, and if his anger is kindled, it would cause him to destroy them from off the face of the earth. Doesn't that fit with the fact of Yeshua's existence in the wilderness? Because if by tempting Yahweh to throw himself off of the temple, what he's done, he's just flaunted the purpose of being here in the face of Yahweh, and he's kindled the anger of Yahweh, and now without the Messiah as an offering, all flesh would have to be destroyed off the face of the earth. Do you see that? Yes. Yes, I see that. By the way, the word nasa, that's translated as tempt, it comes from the root of one of the names or titles of Yahweh. How many of you ever heard Jehovah Nisi or Yahweh Nisi? It comes from that very same word, nasa. And we translate it as the word banner. Yahweh is the banner over us. And so when he says you shouldn't tempt or you shouldn't nasa Yahweh, it sounds as if he's telling you you shouldn't divert Yahweh from his purpose. Or you shouldn't divert someone else from their purpose with Yahweh. You see that? In other words, why tempt the standard? Does that make sense to you? Now you understand when Yeshua makes the statement, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. You see that? And it just so happens in Isaiah 11:10, it says, in that day there shall be a root out of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign. There's the word ensign. It's the word nasa for the people. And to the nasa, to the one that's lifted up. Listen to me. Yahweh has a standard in the earth, and the standard is his word. If you try and deviate from the standard, that's what Yom Kippur is about. It's about returning to the standard.
Amen.
Not truth. I mean, not traditions. not our religious dogma. It's about returning to the standards of Yahweh, doing what the Torah says, not our man-made traditions, not our man-made interpretations of it. And that's one of the main arguments. That's not what it means to me. I don't care. I just don't care what it means to you. I know what it says. And in order for me to understand it, I need to look at it within the context of the word that I'm examining right here, not taking it out of context. Does that make sense to you? And so what's being shown us here is that Yeshua came for the lost sheep of the house of Israel, the ones that were called Gentiles. And his purpose then was to die or to be lifted up in the process of dying as the standard, the ensign, if you will. The banner, the one that you could rally to, the one that you could see that would be the ransom for you, the one who would be your atonement, the one who would be the covering provided for you. To go any other direction to try and circumvent that would be to tempt Yahweh. Does that make sense? Satan knew the plan of Yahweh to redeem his people, and Yeshua reminded him of who was standing in front of him. The one in front of Satan here was the banner of Yahweh, his standard, the Torah. And that's why Yeshua said exactly what I quoted to you earlier. Now, it's interesting because Yeshua is making a reference here not only to the fact that he, as the word, would be lifted up in the earth and draw people, but he's also making a reference to the way that he would be executed on an execution stand. And he's also calling our attention to the fact that a terrible price would have to be paid so that you could receive ransom. Listen to me. Sin requires death. How many of you ever read Romans 5 verse 12 where it says, "For by one man's sin, death entered into the world, and because of sin, death fell on every man." And so every one of us is guilty of sin. Every one of us have incurred the death penalty, and Yeshua had to ransom you to keep you from having to die. Listen to me. Without that ransom, you are going to die. And when I talk about dying, I'm not talking about just this old fleshly body lying down. I'm talking about separating the second death, separated from forever from the presence of Yahweh. That's the death that I'm talking about. And so there was a terrible ransom that was paid. Not only what took place on the execution stake, but even prior to getting through to the execution stake, when he was scourged and he was beaten and he was bruised. I want to show you something here. I want to show you something about Yom Kippur. And it occurs in what is, you look, read it, it's just kind of mundane and it's thrown in there. And it's one of the things you just read where the priest goes in and he dips his finger in the blood and he sprinkles it seven times. And we think that he just kind of went in there, "Oh yeah, let's get this finished. Let's finish the business." That's not what it, there's a prescribed way that he was supposed to offer this blood on the day of Yom Kippur. Now he goes in before, throughout the course of the year, and he offers up sacrifices. And at those particular times, he also sprinkles blood on the people. But he does it different those other occasions. This one time on Yom Kippur, the blood has to be applied at the top of the Ark of the Covenant. And the rabbis agree that the motion that the high priest would have had to have made, according to the oral law in the Babylonian Talmud, tractate Yoma 15a, that he would make a motion, and that motion is referred to as ki matzlif, and the motion would be as if one was being whipped, or if one was the lectern who was whipping another. And it's written here, "Have we not learned that he sprinkled thereof once upwards and then seven times downwards?" Did you hear what was said? Once upwards and seven times downwards. Listen to what's happening here. Like the movement of a swinging whip of one giving lashes. Ironically, this motion was acknowledged as originally written in Hebrew, ki matzliv, like a cross. But this presented a serious problem for the sages. Because by doing that, they would have to acknowledge that the way Yeshua was scourged and finally executed fulfilled this Yom Kippur requirement, so they changed that.
Wow.
Okay? Nonetheless, what happens on Yom Kippur is a shadow picture of when that blood of that goat is scattered, sprinkled on the top of the Ark of the Covenant. It's a picture of Yahweh himself being scourged as the penalty for your sins. And there's another intriguing parallel regarding these two goats. Can y'all hold on a little while longer?
Yeah.
Matthew 27, 15 through 22. And you see here that it's at what we would refer to as the crucifixion, or the week that Yeshua is going through the crucifixion, and he's finally brought before Pilate. And after having scourged Yeshua, Pilate makes a powerful statement. He says, "I find no fault in him." Remember that? And it says that he believes that the only reason that they're bringing him here is because the Jews himself has something against Yeshua. "But I find no fault in him." That's basically what it says. And so he comes up with a novel idea, which happened to be a tradition at that particular time, but the tradition is ironic because it fits the Yom Kippur shadow picture. And so the tradition said that they would take a notable prisoner and bring them before the people, and the people could have a choice, this notable prisoner or Yeshua. We'll release one of them. And the notable prisoner at this particular time was known as Barabbas. You ever read that? The word Barabbas in Hebrew is Bar Abbas, and it's translated as son of the father, but that word Bar can also mean one that has been chosen or one that's pure. So he could literally represent the chosen son of Yahweh. And it's also a fact, and in some of the ancient translations, the Syriac translations, and it was intentionally removed because they did not want you to see some things that was in the ancient text. The ancient translations say that this man, Barabbas, was also named Yeshua Barabbas.
Wow.
You have the scapegoat for Yahweh and the goat of Azazel. The picture of Yom Kippur right in front of you. Now, the interesting thing is that both of them were accused of insurrection. What does insurrection mean? Barabbas was a notable enemy. He was a notable prisoner. Why? Because in that particular day, just like Yeshua, the house of Israel were expecting their people to be able to overthrow Rome and restore the kingdom to Israel. Wasn't that what was asked Yeshua? When are you going to restore the kingdom? And he said, it's not for you to know that time. They were expecting Yeshua to come and restore the kingdom. But they also, history verifies the fact that this man named Barabbas was also considered a Messiah figure, and Barabbas was trying to do in the flesh, in the natural, what Yeshua came to do in the spirit realm, to set the people free. Barabbas was chosen for Yahweh, and he was set free as an example of one who tried to liberate or redeem the people through insurrection against Rome. And it's interesting, Barabbas was trying to cover himself and cover the people. And Barabbas was not a proper covering. Barabbas was like a fig leaf garment. You see what I'm saying? And so Barabbas was sent out into exile while Yeshua was executed. Isn't that amazing? And let me share something with you. The future anti-Messiah is coming, and he's going to be another Barabbas. There are many, including a lot of individuals in the house of Judah and Israel and the Hebrew roots community today, that are going to acknowledge this future anti-Messiah, this future Yeshua Barabbas, as the Messiah. And they're going to look towards this one who's charismatic and expect him to bring peace. In fact, he's going to say, "Peace." Are you with me? Do you see how all of these patterns overlap and we need to understand them? So what is the message of Yom Kippur here? Well, it's about making Tisha B'Av. It's a fast, it's a day of self-reflection. It's a day we need to gather together for a solemn assembly. We need to afflict ourselves. How many of you ever heard that? We've all heard that, right? In John 3:16, it says, "For Yah so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have what?
Everlasting
life." In other words, when I send him to go down into the wilderness, he doesn't come back. And in verse 17, it says, "For Yah sent not his Son into the world to do what?
Condemn
the world, but that the world through him might be saved." And in Micah chapter 7, verse 18 and 19, it tells us that Yahweh pardons iniquity and transgression, and he doesn't retain his anger forever. He will turn again. He will have compassion upon us. He will subdue our iniquities. And he will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. Yeshua became the ransom forever, removing the sin from the house of Israel if they would only accept that blood sacrifice. Now, it's interesting if you continue to look at this word Azazel, it has a numeric value of 115. 115 happens to be the value of the word Sinai, which is the Hebrew word that's translated as bush or thorn bush, and it's that same bush that was on fire when Moses saw it. And it just so happens that it has the same root as the word Sinai, the Psalmic noon root, and it hints at an advocate, one who pleads, one who litigates for another, and it also indicates a learned man who has the ability to litigate on your behalf. And so when we enter in Yom Kippur and we take advantage of the covering, then when the enemy comes to tempt you to cast yourself off top of the mountain or to turn these stones into bread, or to do some other tradition in because you are concerned that your sins are coming back when you've been forgiven of those sins. Now listen to me. Listen to me. Many of you get tormented because the enemy constantly reminds you of sin that you have asked forgiveness of. And if Yahweh forgives you, he forgets them. He casts them into the sea. The enemy reminds you of that. If Yahweh's forgiven you, he's forgotten those sins. The goat's not come back. So you need to understand that when he sets you free, you're free. And that's exactly what Yom Kippur is about. And to add a little more emphasis, if you look at the numeric value of 115, and you were to take just arbitrarily the 115th chapter of Torah, it's Leviticus chapter 25, and you find Yahweh speaking right there in the first verse from Mount Sinai. And he's introducing to the children of Israel a celebration known as the Jubilee, the Yovel. And the Yom Kippur and Jubilee go hand in hand because it's at Yom Kippur that the Jubilee was announced. We're about to enter into the 120th Jubilee. And guess what? How can I be overwhelmed, afflicting my soul, knowing that I'm about to be set free? And everything that had been sold, everything that had been lost, all of the debt that I had incurred all of my life is now about to be expunged. I'm about to have all of my possessions returned. Even though I have been sold into bondage, into slavery, I am now set free. Why? Because I have been ransomed by the blood of the King. And it's interesting. I just search for these little clues that I can tie them all together and just make this look really appetizing to you. But it's not what happens. This is something Yahweh does. That word Nasa, Yehovah Nasa, Yehovah Nisi, has a numeric value of 115 as well. And so what do I do at Yom Kippur? I raise the standard high or I don't. If I don't, I tempt Yahweh. So how can I truly celebrate Yom Kippur? How can I honor the King on Yom Kippur? In the book of Zechariah, there's mention of the fast of the seventh month, which is Yom Kippur. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, oh, that's it, seventh month, Yom Kippur. Zechariah 7, verse 5. And he speaks a very sobering question, a very sobering statement in front of the people. And he says, speaking to all the people of the land and to the priests, saying, when you fasted, and everybody look at me. Let me kind of go around and catch your eyes. Everybody look at me. If you don't see somebody looking at me, punch them. Look at me. Yahweh's speaking to you. When you fasted and you mourned in the fifth and the seventh month and do those years in captivity, did you fast unto me really? Was it really a fast unto me? You're about to celebrate Yom Kippur. Are you really doing it for me? That's what he's saying. Are you really doing this for me? See, that ought to be just ringing in your spirit, man. Your DNA ought to be literally vibrating. Here's what he says in response. It's more than just afflicting yourselves. It's about a change of heart. And if you really have a true change of heart, it'll be demonstrated by a change in your actions. It is a somber day of reflection, but it's a somber day because you haven't taken care of business yet. You can see your failures if you haven't dealt with them, but it's also a day of rejoicing knowing that the opportunity there is for you to remedy your own situation. And right there in Zechariah, verse 9 and 10 tells us this. And this is Yahweh speaking. He makes it very clear regarding the fast of Yom Kippur. He says that he much prefers that his people act with justice and kindness and compassion toward one another rather than simply keeping a fast day. Thus speaks Yahweh Shalom, saying, execute true judgment, seek mercy and compassion every man to his brother, and oppress not the widow nor the fatherless, the stranger nor the poor, and let none of you imagine evil against his brother in your heart. Go back and look at it. It's talking about Yom Kippur right here. And if you do that, then you honor him. And it goes on to say that these days of fasting will become festivals of celebration. Zechariah 8:19. Thus saith Yahweh Sabaoth, the fast of the fourth month, and the fast of the fifth, and the fast of the seventh, and the fast of the tenth month. All of those traditions that were added to encumber everybody and make you so conscious of the fact that your goat's going to come back. That's what it's about. Your goat's coming back. Well, what if I'm covered by the blood of the Lamb? If I'm covered by the blood of the Lamb and I know a ransom price has been paid for me, then what it says here, to the house of Judah shall be joy and gladness and cheerful feasts. Therefore, love the truth and Shalom. Give God a praise.